Thank you so much, guys. Thank you so much for inviting me here in Berlin. I'm very excited to speak on this topic. As it says, it's mastering the art of A-B testing. It sounds good?
Yes.
Okay, so let's go ahead then. A little bit about myself. My name is Kapil Bakshi. I started speaking since November 2017 last year. And these are my international conferences where my talks have been getting selected. My first international talk was DroidCon Beijing 2017. Last month, I was in Russia to speak on test-driven development. And my talk was also got selected at Android Makers France, Droid Kaiki Tokyo, and recently DroidCon Vienna as well. So I've been speaking a lot on test-driven development in Android. I have also set up test-driven development pipeline from scratch at my company, and also helped other companies, been helping other companies in India, as well as worldwide, to set up test-driven development, right? Today, I'm speaking on A-B testing, and I work at a company called Blackbuck. It is a Series C-funded startup in India, and we are into logistics. So if a client wants to transport his goods or his products from one place to another, we are like Uber for them, right? So we help them optimize the routes, we help them optimize their loads, and also help different truck owners or the fleet owners get different goods, and also help the clients to transport their goods from one place to another. And we are also working on some of the IoT-driven products. Take, for example, if a fleet owner or a truck owner wants to find out if his driver is doing some fraud on the fuel, right? If he's doing rash driving or harsh driving, we have different sensors for that. And so all in all, we are driving the entire logistics landscape in India. And we have received a funding of more than $150 million. And we are funded by Tiger Global and Axel Partners, right? So that is about myself and my background. So let me jump to the topic now. So all of us, we as companies or startups, we have that conquest to impress the users, right? We want them to get wowed by our app such that they get addicted to it, right? And then whatever we want, we can do. We can drive the users. That is what we want, right? That is what our aim is. Okay, so what do we do for that, right? We identify the requirements. Either we take it from the user, the real-time feedback, or some of us also go ahead. We look at the data, right? And then we design the solutions. And then ultimately, we roll out the app, right? But the possibilities of designing solutions, these are endless, right? I can have design one, design two, design three, and whatnot, right? And another thing is that we have the mindset of the user is quite unpredictable. I don't know what the user wants, how exactly he'll react. If he'll generate a lot of revenue for me, a lot of engagement would be there or not, that is unpredictable, right? We can only rely on hypothesis. We do not surely know that what exactly the result would be, or the results would be, right? So what is the solution? What is the solution to optimize my designs, right? To optimize my phase of designing the solutions for the users? The answer is very simple. Let users tell us themselves in real time. Okay, and how we can do that? Let's see. So as I told, we have endless possibilities. I can have version 1, version 2, version 3. So if I have a serial approach, if I roll out serially, I can roll out version 1 in 1 week. After week 2, I change another version, then another version. Then it'll take a lot of time for me, right? The process would be very time-taking. What I can do is, I can roll out my versions in parallel, right? And I can distribute to different users, different segment of users. And that too in real time. And then I can determine which is the leader on the basis of my goals or my engagement. So as you can see here, this version is performing very, very well. Then this version and this, and then this version. So when I identify my leader or the best performer, I can roll it out to the entire user base. So that is the crux of A-B testing, rolling out my features in parallel, right? And then finding out the leader, and then pushing that to all the users. Okay, so if we don't A-B test, we only rely on hypothesis. I can only think, right? Or I can suppose, But with the help of A-B testing, I can say that, you know, yes, I know. I know the exact solution, right? I know how the users are performing. Okay, so some important terminologies, right? So we have a control group. The control group, as you can say in A-B testing, by default, the A version is my control group, right? And which is the default version, which would be rolled out to all the users. It's not the experimented version, right? And if you see here B, this is my B version, which is also called a variant, right? So what is the significance of having a control version, right? Because doing nothing is a decision in itself. Take, for example, I decide to roll out some notifications to particular users. So rolling out those notifications is one decision, and not rolling out is also a very important decision for me, right? Because doing nothing is also very important. So that is where the significance of control group comes into picture. That is like the default version, right, of your A-B testing. We also have something called multivariate testing. So take, for example, in my A-B testing, I had this app of, you know, booking a flight. So what I did was I am playing around with the color of this button, right? This book now button. The variant has this orange color, but this has the blue color, right? So in multivariate testing, what happens is I'm playing around with much more parameters, right? I have this banner image, right? So I've also included one more variable in my A-B testing, such that now I have four versions. One version would be this book now button, which would be having banner one, and then another which would be having this orange button with banner image one, and then all these combinations, right? So in multivariate testing, we are having much more parameters into consideration, right? A combination of parameters, rather. So when do you A-B test? And when you do multivariate testing? So for A-B testing, you do when you have less number of users, right? And when you have just started A-B testing, right? You just play around with only one parameter because the number of users is quite less, right? And you've just started. And when do you do multivariate testing? It's for, you know, having some fine-grained A-B testing approach in the sense that you have more number of users and you've already tried A-B testing before, right? It's just like moving a step further, right? Including more parameters, a combination of parameters in your A-B testing. Okay. Another main important thing of A-B testing, the main component of A-B testing, are the goals. What end results we are targeting, right? So these end results can be the number of clicks, or the rise in engagement on your app, or maybe the signups, the rise in signups, or ultimately maybe your revenue, right? So these are your goals, which you're targeting, which should come in the end. And what about some steps which you should do before A-B testing, right? So first of all, you should identify the user pain points or the bottlenecks, right? You should identify the drop-offs. For that, what you can do is you can do some funnel analysis. You can use tools like Firebase Analytics and Mixpanel. You can also use heat maps to find out where exactly the user is clicking, where exactly he's not clicking. For that, you can use tools like Appsy, right? And yeah, and define some quantifiable success metrics or the goals. So what I'll be telling about today is doing A-B testing using Firebase Remote Config, right? So first of all, the question should come, why Firebase Remote Config? So what exactly is Firebase Remote Config? So it's a parameter-based approach such that you get from the cloud which parameter you want to have your variable associated to. Take, for example, here. This color is coming from the remote config for the book now button. I would get the blue color or the orange color, right? So it's a parameter-based approach. And yeah, why Firebase Remote Config? So first of all, it's very coupled with Firebase Analytics, right? Be it my number of clicks or the page views, or take, for example, user retention data or the engagement data, right? Firebase Analytics has all of that. And Firebase Remote Config is very tightly coupled with that. Right? So what I can do is I can define all the goals with the help of those parameters, right? And then I can fetch all those as inputs to Firebase Remote Config. And what I'll have is an amazing A-B testing pipeline, right? Because the data I have in my Firebase Analytics, That would help me define the goals for me very clearly and very methodically, right? So I'll take an example of a sample app, right? So I have this app which is called the memory game, in which I'll be given some time to memorize the positions of all these tiles, right? And after a particular amount of time, let's say 10 seconds or let's say 15 seconds, I would be shown an image here and I need to guess the correct position of this game, of this tile, right? And if I tap on all of the slides or all of the tiles, my game gets over, right? So this is the game I'll be applying A-B testing on. Setting up, so how do we set up Firebase remote config? So in my Gradle file, I include the latest version, right? And then on my Firebase console, I click on A-B testing. You'll see this particular dialog wherein you can create the experiment, right? And then you should click on remote config. And then here, what I'm doing here is, I'm playing around with the memorizing time, right? So instead of giving the user 15 seconds to memorize the entire tile's positions, let's say I'm giving here 12 seconds, right? Because a user might find it, some users might find it quite difficult, you know, because the time is less. Some would also find it quite boring because the time is a lot more, right? So I'm playing around with the time here, the memorizing time. Okay, and then in my Android code, I instantiate Firebase remote config. And then here, this method is called set defaults. I'm setting the default, right? The default value of the memorizing time. And I'm calling the set defaults method on my Firebase remote config object. And how do I fetch my parameters from the cloud? I have this async task here, right? And what this argument is, it's the cache expiration time. So it is the time after which my Firebase remote config would fetch the parameters again from the remote config, right? So here it's 12 hours. So till 12 hours, it won't be fetching the remote config, right? It would fetch from the cache. And then here's a listener. So whenever I get the value, so this is the variable countdown time value. This I would be fetching with this key, the value corresponding to this key. Okay, so now let A-B testing begin on this sample project of ours, right? So the main phases of doing A-B testing are, first of all, we create the experiment. I'll be going through all of these in detail. We create the experiment. We select the target users. Whom do we want to roll out, you know, this A-B test to, based on some factors. We define the variants, like I spoke about different versions. And then we define the goals, what goals we are targeting. Is it the retention rate, the revenue rate, the rise in the number of clicks, or let's say any other factor, any other goal. And then we analyze the results, right? So first of all, let's select the target users. So here you can see I create my experiment. The target users, I can apply some filter on the country. And then I can also select the percentage to which my version would be rolled out, right? So if this 10% here, these are the users which would have the control version, the default version, as well as my variants, right? So let's see how exactly we are distributing the variants. But a point to note that is the A-B test would only run on 10% of our users. That would also include the control version as well, the default version. Okay, so I can also apply some more filters based on, you know, the audience. I can also have some of my properties, which I spoke about, the number of clicks, or let's say any other page views. I can also apply that, right? A lot of filters I can apply to target the users. And so here I'm creating the variants. So as you can see, this is the control version, which is the default version. So along with playing with the memorizing time, I'm also playing around with the number of tiles, right? So by default, the game had 9 slides. So what if a particular user may find it quite difficult to memorize the 9 slides, right? I can also reduce the number of slides and see if the engagement is increasing or not, right? So one version would have the memorizing time that is increased to 20 seconds. And the other version would be dealing with the number of tiles, right? it would be having 6 lights to make it less difficult, right? Less difficult means more engaging. We can say that, right? And then here, I'm defining my goal. So my goal for this A-B test is increase in user engagement, right? And I've added another goals you can add, you know, retention for 4 days, daily user engagement, right? A lot of goals you can add. And I can also link my test devices as well. So if I want a particular version to be rolled out to a particular device for testing, I can write down my Firebase instance ID, which is applicable to that particular token, which would be generated for that particular device. And then I can decide which version I want to roll out to that particular device. The control version, or this variant, right? For testing, I can do it. So let's start the experiment now. OK, so I click on Start Experiment, and this is the message which comes to me. It's too early to declare a leader, right? Because A-B testing that is based on Bayesian statistics, it needs a good amount of sample space and some time to find out the exact leader. We'll see in the upcoming slides how exactly does it happen. OK, so let's wait for around 2 weeks. This is the default time for which you should run your A-B testing, right? So after 2 weeks, what happens? Let's see the results. So I get this message saying that there is no leader yet in achieving your primary goal. So what is the reason? Why did we not get a leader? Right? Because this was my personal app. This was not, this had very less users, maybe some of my friends or some of my colleagues, right? Resulting in a very less sample space or the number of users. And that is why no concrete result, right? Like, as I told you, A-B testing is based on some Bayesian statistics. For that, it needs decent amount of sample space and time period to run my test cases on, right? To ensure that this particular increase or this particular results are not because of some random chance. It is because of the changes you made. Right? It's because of the changes you made. So that is why you should have a lot number of users, let's say around 2,000 or 3,000 monthly active, daily active users, right? Okay, so now let's take another example. So take, for example, there is a company, there is a gaming company, and they want to remove ads from their apps, right? They want to see if removing the ads results in more user retention or not, right? Hypothetically, you would think that since we are pushing a lot of ads, that should result, that should decline user retention or user engagement, right? So now let's not depend on our hypothesis. Let's see the data. Let's see what data tells us. Okay, so does removing ads improve my user retention? Let's see the results. So I got this result, saying that there is no leader in achieving your primary goal, right? And as you can also see, we have more number of users. So it's not because we have less number of users and we didn't get any leader, right? So what does it mean? It means that removing ads does not have any effect on my user retention, right? So had the company removed the ads, right? So had we hypothetically taken that decision of removing the ad, we would have lost a lot of profit, right? Our profit would have declined. So it's the data. My A-B test told me that I don't actually need to remove the ads, right, in order to improve user retention, right? So this is a very good example. Yeah, so now I know. Earlier I was thinking, but now I know that, you know, removing ads does not have any effect on user retention. Okay, so what is the con of Firebase Remote Config? One con is that it does not have a visual editor. Take, for example, we have tools like Mixpanel, or let's say other A-B testing platforms, wherein you have a visual editor like this, and you can directly, you know, change your UI or your configs via that visual editor, right? It's a parameter-based approach on Firebase Remote Config. Yeah, like as I spoke about Mixpanel, you can directly bring about variations using a visual editor, right? So what are the conclusions, you know, of A-B testing? One conclusion, avoid configuring unrelated parameters, right? So if you see my example, I have played independently with number of tiles and memorizing time. Had I coupled them together, right? So if you see here, variant A is not playing with the number of tiles. Variant B is not playing with the memorizing time. It's playing around with the number of tiles, right? So had I coupled them together, what would have happened was, I wouldn't have known that which factor, you know, led to my goals, right? Is it the number of tiles or the memorizing time which has improved my user retention, right? So your variance should be, you know, should not be related to each other, right? We should not configure unrelated parameters, right? Because if I found that, you know, reducing the number of tiles brings me more retention, so this should be isolated of the other parameters, right? These should not get overlapped, my parameters. Okay. Another big conclusion is that we should not test if our number of users is quite less, because we won't be getting a leader or a winner, right? We should consider that as well. And then not getting a leader is as important as getting a leader, right? Because we saw here, in this case, removing the ads had no, you know, effect on user retention. So in this case, we didn't have a leader. Our control group was performing better, right? Or nearly equal to removing the ads, right? So, and another big conclusion is that you should choose your metrics quite wisely, right? So like I spoke about, you can have mixed panel, you can do funnel analysis and see whether drop-offs are happening. And then you can decide the goals. You can use APSI to do some heat map analysis and see how exactly people, you know, are interacting on your app. So APSI, what it does is it records all the interactions, how the users are interacting with your app, right? So yeah, so this is what I would like to say. This is it from my side. If you have any questions, you can let me know. Thank you.
Yeah, I have to say I'm a bit scared of the user experience if you change parameters on the fly, just like changing the numbers of tiles, what the user isn't used to in the app before, and changing the color of a button might be, oh, is there something wrong? Why is the button orange instead of blue? So you have to be really conscious probably to use the A/B testing. Or what's your opinion about it?
I didn't get you. Can you please repeat? What exactly are you trying to say?
I think the user experience might suffer if you change the app on the fly with... If you change the app with A/B testing?
No. So what we can do is, like I showed you the code here. So we can only fetch when the user starts the app again, right? If the user is in the middle of the app, then we should not do it, because that would be very confusing to the user.
Yeah, but if the user already used the app, and something is different, the next time he uses it, it's also pretty confusing to the user.
No. So first of all, the entire idea of A/B testing is to find the goals first. I won't be rolling out my A/B testing campaign if everything is okay. So I'm rolling out A/B testing because I think that I see from the data that the user engagement is not that high, right? So I would think that maybe the number of tiles is more to guess, right? The time is quite less for the person to guess. So that is why I would try playing around with these parameters, right? And see if something better can be done. I would see my goals first. So like I told you first here, first you should identify your goals, right?
Yeah.
So if you see the goals here, identifying the goals. So what you can do is, you can see your data, you know, your Firebase Analytics, your Mixed Panel, or your APSI. And then ultimately, with the help of, by identifying those goals, you'll be rolling out the campaign,
okay,
right? So it's not that, you know, one day you think that, you know, A/B testing sounds quite good, let's go ahead with A/B testing, right? So ultimately, we are doing for the user.
Yeah.
Because we sense from the data that something is not happening correctly, right? So that is my opinion on that.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah.
Yeah, I have a question regarding the Firebase. Have you ever run more than one experiment in parallel? Did you have problem defining them?
Where?
Running more than one A/B test experiment in parallel at the same time.
In parallel?
So like having two experiments running
so
at the same
time? So I
think
in our company, we have run one. There's another team which is running, right? On the same app, we haven't done, you know, more parallelly. So this is another good practice. It's a bad practice, actually, to run A/B tests in parallel. So one of the main good practices of A/B testing is that you should run your tests, A/B tests in isolation, right? Because if you do in parallel, you can do in parallel if the things are unrelated. Let's say you run your A/B test on one page, you can have another A/B test on the other page, which are unrelated to each other. That is why there won't be overlap, right? So you should avoid overlapping as much as possible, right? So that is how it should be.
You said that multi-dimensional
multi-variance.
Yeah, multi-variance. So going in different dimensions. So one dimension is a time, and one dimension is the
number
of tiles. You said that you should not combine them, or it doesn't give you good
because the
answers.
Thing is,
but
the thing is that in one variant, you're playing around with two parameters simultaneously. Hmm. You're playing around with the number of tiles, and you're also playing around with the time actually, and you get a winner. Let's say you get winner A. You won't be able to know that the decrease in number of tiles led to the winner or the increase in the memorizing time.
That's correct. But you still have some information. You know that this combination is working the best, and you can use this as a default for the next time. Of course, you don't get the...
Yeah, you can do it.
You cannot say, okay, which dimension in which direction is
So I'll tell you what. So it should be done if your parameters are related. Take, for example, you have a background text, you have a header, you have a banner image. In that you have, let's say, white text and black background. Those are related, right? So that can be combined as one variant, right? Because you'll come to know that this variant, if there's a change, it's because of this, because these are related. If things are unrelated, you won't be able to find out as to which change, which tweak did the thing for you.
Correct.
That entire, although you'll find a winner, you'll see that this is the best combination for you, but that exact user behavior, right? So if I'm talking about the increase in number of time or the decrease in number of slides, it's a very important, outcome for me. Very important for me to find out that is it the increase in time or the decrease in number of slides. Because let's say for example, I want to have new levels in my game, right? I want to make new features. So this input would be very beneficial to me.
Yeah, and then you should do it in isolation, right?
Yeah, yes, yeah. Yes.
If you want to know this, whether increasing or decreasing.
Yes, so isolation is very important.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So at the time of doing tests on a single device, you were taking some instance ID.
That is for testing.
Yeah, once you start the test on that particular device, is it possible to add another device?
Yes, you can. You can. So I don't know what the slide number is. I would have to browse a lot through the slides. But you can... So you can link any variant of your A/B test experiment with
device.
Yeah, device with any device. Okay. Yeah.
And I want to test variant A in this.
Yeah, and it's possible. Yeah, it's possible.
But okay, once even after starting the experiment, that's possible.
Yes, because it's for testing, right?
Yeah.